Okay. So let me ramble just for a couple of minutes, and then we want to hear from you folks. As I said in the beginning, the first few meetings, I looked out at you, and I'm looking at 60 type A personalities who are used to doing something, and when they get in a room, they want to act. And you're all really intelligent people, and you're volunteering your time to come here because you care about Vermont, and you want to make improvements. And I saw it's getting mired in bureaucracy, which unfortunately we had to, because we have to comply with all the federal regulations, and the agency secretaries and deputy secretaries and commissioners that are here know this better than anyone, and our legislators that are here know it as well. So thank you for your patience with us. We've now created this operating committee, and we'll deal with all the mundane baloney and anything that we need to take to you, we're going to take to you. But we'd really like to use your time to be creative. Before, I just want to acknowledge Tom Longstreth of Resource just won a really significant youth build grant that was extremely competitive, and he did a really creative job, and I just wanted to say thank you. So I know how I came to think what I think and where I am. I'll give you a little background of what I do for work and the boards I serve on, and then how life throws you a curveball, and then you just keep going. Mm-hmm. So I started out in real estate because my dad was in real estate, and he said to me when I was a junior in college, go get your real estate license. I didn't know why. Found out why. You make pretty good money for doing not really complicated work, at least at the time. Then technology came. So I did that for a couple of years, decided to take a break. From that, I wanted to learn industrial real estate. I thought I was learning industrial real estate, and ended up running Franklin County Industrial Development Corporation, which is an economic development corporation. So I had a pretty good feel for that, and then went and started a few businesses with some friends that I went to UVM with, did that for a while, and then my dad kind of wanted to retire, so I went back into real estate, and was doing really well. Technology came on, and just embraced technology coming into that field. And the National Association of Realtors, at the time I was on their board, they basically looked at us and they go, in 5 years, two-thirds of you are going to be gone. A third of you are going to fire yourselves. A third of you are going to be just gone. And the other third are either going to find a way to make it with technology, or you're just going to be replaced. And that's exactly what happened. So we started on that path, and then a good friend of mine who I've been helping on serving on some state boards ended up getting a phone call that our governor died, and he was governor. His name was Howard Dean. So Tom, Tordy, and I, and a few others here, Scott worked for Howard. And he called me one afternoon. I've been working with him, serving on the State Community Development Board and a couple other boards, and then helping him put together ideas and moving forward. And he said to me, the ag commissioner just died. And I go, yeah, I know. And he said, well, what do you think I ought to do? So you don't have any choice. You got to appoint a dairy farmer either from Franklin or Addison County. He goes, that's why I'm calling you. He's like, I want to appoint you to the state senate. And I said, absolutely not. So I can't, you know, I've got two younger kids. So I am frustrated with the permitting process in Vermont, and I'll tell you what, you're losing your economic development commissioner in June. I'll come in, I'll give you 2 years, and we'll work with the team there, and we'll restructure your agency of commerce, and I'm going to leave. I'll jump in 2 years and get out 2 years. So I ended up going in, working with some great people in the dean administration and government. A lot of them are here in this room, and then I got the bug to keep doing it. Greg McGuire was our agency counsel. Tom was commissioner of buildings. Scott did numerous things. Diane was there. Diane's husband was a commissioner as well. A lot of the folks in the dean years went on to do other things, and now you see them around the state. The one thing I think that we did really well was we tried to break down the silos between government and realize that that we couldn't make it alone without cooperating with other agencies and the department. So the Agency of Commerce met weekly with the Department of Labor. We met weekly with the Agency of Transportation. We met biweekly with Agency of Education. We met almost twice a week with Transportation because there was all those projects going on that that met economic development needs. So I drew the form. Basically, my 2 years came. I wanted to leave. We had a project going called Husky. Had to finish that project, and then I left. I didn't know what I was going to do, and then GBIC approached me, and I kind of had the bug to keep doing public service in some way in economic development, so I went on. And GBIC is one of the state's 12 nonprofit regional economic development corporations. So in Vermont, we have 12 regional land use planning commissions, and we have 12 economic development corporations that are nonprofit. Land use planning helps municipalities do their land use plans. If they didn't have zoning, they all have zoning now, but in years ago they didn't. And they help them do their transportation plans. Economic development, we're more micro-focused. And in our region, we're co-located with the Lake Champlain Chamber, who's the largest business organization in the state. And we micro-focus on about 230 employers in Chittenden County. And their profile has to be, they have to be dollar importing, goods and services exporting. So they either gotta make something or add value to a product, or have a service and export that product or service outside of Vermont and bring dollar one into the state economy. That's the first dollar in the economy before it starts multiplying. So that's about 230 employers in Chittenden County, and they employ, I'm looking at Seth, but between 40 and 60,000 people in Chittenden County. So then I jump on some other boards. So I've been on the EVM board. All this is going to come back to what we do and then your ideas. I've been on the EVM board since 2001 and have seen three presidents come and go and seen higher education change in many ways and the cost of higher education just go nuts. And then I see most of the graduates at EVM go somewhere else after they graduate. And I know this situation is similar with the other colleges and universities of Vermont. Then I serve on the Vermont Technology Council and the Vermont Center for Emerging Technologies. And that is the entrepreneurial, innovative, proactive kinds of things that we do, that Joan and I and Lucy do in economic development of Vermont. So we're looking to build the next dealer.coms, the next IDXs, the next Ben and Jerry's, the next Optimist. You know, we're looking to get with small businesses, with people with ideas, with researchers, and nurture their brains, their creative ideas, and their innovation to create the new companies, the new employers in Vermont. And I see what they're dealing with. Then I'm on the Tarrant Foundation board, which is a philanthropic board, and all we do is give away money that Rich Tarrant made, and he's focused his money on teaching teachers how to understand and teach technology in their classrooms. So that's where he's micro-focusing his resources. So we see that continuum. And then I had a passion for both Tom and I and what we do, we're very much involved in Chittenden County and the United Way. And in Chittenden County, we try to get all the players together. And Chittenden County is bigger. So in the other counties in Vermont, I live, come from Franklin County. They're a really good community there, and everybody's pretty much on the same page. But in Chittenden County, it's much bigger, and you really have to pull everyone together to get a true picture of what's going on. So Chittenden County's got the most diverse economy, it's got the most diverse population, it's got a lot of poverty, it's got a lot of opportunity, we've got the majority of the institutions of higher education there, we've got a lot of resources, we've got a lot of problems, and we've got a lot of challenges. So Mary Powell is one of the Vermonters that I look to as like a real innovator. And a dozen years ago, Mary Powell said to the Vermont Business Roundtable, pre-K, universal full-time pre-K, is the best systemic investment that we could make in this state to change outcomes for children and their mothers and young families and our communities. And you can't measure it real quick, but it's probably the best investment we can make. So I end up on the pre-K commission with Paul and Rebecca and another number of other folks, and we're looking at how the heck are we going to be able to afford it, and what's the number? What's the number of children we're dealing with from 0 to 5 years old? It's only 37,000 kids. So, you know, in some areas that's nothing. That's like a quarter of a ward, of a school ward district. But it's $400 million a year. Where do we find the $400 million a year? In a year where the employers here are saying, you can't tax us anymore. And then we listen to the gubernatorial candidates saying, we got to grow our population. Vermont has got to produce more income. Revenues, the cost of services are going up. And then you listen to families saying that they're not, you know, very few people are doing better than they were doing a number of years ago. Costs keep going up. So my question to you is this, and I have talked to Governor Shumlin about this, and he would really like creative ideas, and he does and is staying on top of what we're doing and the challenges that we're looking at. We're in a weird period, and the weird period, never mind economically, I'll give you one for instance. Chittenden County normally leads the state in the applications for economic incentives. So economic incentives, somebody applies for economic incentives. An employer applies for them if they're going to make big hiring decisions in a 3 to 5 year period, or they're going to make big capital investments in a 3 to 5 year period. We normally have 60 to 70% of the applications and awards in Chittenden County. In the past 18 months, we have had one application and one award. So I don't know what that, I'm not an economist, I, you know, I get in the room and talk with Matt Berowitz, with Jeff Carr or Wolf, and you know, find out what they think is going on. Is it changes in the global economy? Is globalism is changing? Is it all the political changes that are going on in the world? Is it that we just don't know who's going to be the next president yet, and everyone's kind of sitting on their hands? Is it angst that we don't know who the next governor's going to be or what the next policy is going to be? I don't know those answers. But that's a backdrop of a lot of what we're dealing with today. So what I'm asking you, from wherever you come from, the last time we got together, we divided the group with employers in one area, and then you resource providers in another area. And I know the resource providers in this room know what they could better do or how they could better integrate their resources. And the employers in this room know what they need or what they're going to need, but we didn't have that dialogue with each other the last time. And so I'd like to use the next time that we have, and we can get out of here early if you want to get out of here early, or we could come up with lists of creative ideas. And it doesn't really matter what your creative ideas are, and they can be in the area that you work in. What I don't want to hear is war stories, things that aren't working. What we really like to look at is our workforce today and the workforce we're going to need in the future. And you heard the projection from Kevin about the jobs that are coming. But what I know about the jobs that are existing is that most of those jobs are going to change. And what I know about how people have saved for retirement is we all haven't saved that well. So people are going to be working a lot longer, which is actually going to help the workforce. People may retire from what they're doing, but they may work in other occupations. And when I look at who we're going to have for a workforce in Vermont, I have to be really simple. I have to be really simple about who we're most likely to get to work here and to continue to work here. Who are they? They're the people who want to live here or are going to live here. So you start out with, they're the 3,000, why do we talk about career and technical education? Because 2,500 kids every year graduate from high school and they don't go on to anything right now. And then of the ones that do, the next year we lose, and the next three semesters we lose another 1,000, or 800, 900. So there's 3,500 Vermonters that we're going to end up with, that some of them are sitting on the corner of Champlain Farms or wherever they're sitting. And but they're the ones that are going to stay here. And we got to find ways to better educate and train them so that they can make a decent living and have families and provide for themselves and not be statistics in the court system and corrections, so that they can, you know, have a meaningful life here. Then we have the incumbent workers who are working in jobs right now, and their jobs are going to totally change. And we got to retrain those people. And they want to work. And they are working. So there's another population cohort. And that's a big population cohort. And then where are we going to get the highly skilled and educated workers? Well, there are 40,000 students in our institutions of higher education here in Vermont. They chose to come here. They chose to go to school here. We need a better way of doing things like Champlain College does, of pushing them all into internships in their first year of their experience and introducing them to employers here in Vermont. And that is certainly the publicly funded institutions in the state, UVM, and I'm on the board there, and the state colleges. If you're going to receive public money, then you're going to start doing this. You have to do it. And we got to find a more creative way of making academic success plans and career success plans a top priority of every first-year student at every one of our institutions of higher education in Vermont. So those are just some random thoughts. And I wanted to be a little bit provocative about it, and then to bring everything down to like ground zero, my daughter drops dead on April 9th, and she's a single mom, and now I'm raising a three-year-old, well, it'll be three next week, who is autistic, and it kind of makes you real, and it kind of brings you right back down to, you know, we're starting to plan for retirement, whatever. We're not planning for retirement anymore. We're doing the ANSCO marching one by one on the way on the way to whatever we're doing. And at that level, I'm seeing the incredible dynamic programs that we have in early education in this state. So you are all really, really bright people, and you all have great experience. Let's take the next hour or whatever you want to spend and let's just throw out some ideas. John Kasich, who's governor of Ohio, just blew up his state workforce development board 2 weeks ago and said, it isn't working, we're not doing it right. We need to get focus. Well, I can tell you right now from talking with both of them, Sue Minter and Phil Scott, the two likely candidates that, well, probably one of them's gonna win to be the next governor, want your ideas. And they want us to use our time to generate a bunch of creative ideas. So if you can, start firing at us. We're gonna take notes, and then we're gonna get back to you with what we kind of came up with today. But I'll stop there, and please, let's have at it. Mike.
So after the last meeting, I think when I was sitting with all the business people, we were frustrated that all we focus on in this group is the educational component.
Really speak up well for everybody.
Sure. So what we wanted, which came out, was, you know, how do we get more focus on what businesses want for incentives and so forth? And I think a lot of businesses just gave up on the incentives in Vermont that are currently out there because they're just a giant pain to go get and then track. And that needs to be really simplified. Like, that's the other portion of this component is, yeah, we can educate people more, but the reality is we want more jobs. Mm-hmm. What's the incentive for employers to scale more jobs? Like, that's the component that's really missing that we don't talk about enough as part of this. And you must hear that all the time.
What yeah, we want. We have to help administer the programs that we have, and then we have to go into the legislature and defend them as corporate giveaway, which is baloney, but whatever. Greg?
Yeah, Frank. again, I'm from Revision.
Speak up.
Yeah, sorry about that. Getting over a chest cold. So, the things that I want to share is that we've grown in Vermont and have had that experience, and the two things that I'll touch on. One is to underline what Frank just said about internships and our experience with internships, because we, like every other company, struggles to get skilled workforce. And even though that skilled workforce, 40,000 kids or students in Vermont, there's a disconnect. And we've reached out to local colleges, both here and where we elsewhere do business up in Quebec. So we have experience elsewhere. Champlain College does an excellent job. Our reach to every higher education institute in Cheyenne County, Champlain College, came, sat in the boardroom with us. They heard what our challenges are, and they actually helped us. I was able to hire somebody to help us with counterfeiting problems in China from Champlain College. So that helped me. I know it helped them. Definitely helped the student. So I underline what Frank says. Those internships, we all got to do a much better job, including business, to identify how we can make that, integrate that into what we do. It is time consuming, but it is highly valuable. So I'll underline it. Second thing is, we talk about how we have businesses in Vermont grow, how we attract businesses to Vermont. I'll say that we sometimes oversell the concept of incentives. Incentives are important, but we have to also remember that it's hard for Vermont, given its size, to compete with other states that may have more robust incentive programs. I think we need to sell what we got. Skilled workforce is a very excellent selling point. The environment in which we live, the communities that we have here, are all positive. However, there's very few of us who live in this marvelous state who pay taxes, and we can't forget that. The tax burden is not only one that our corporations have an eyeball on, it's also the tax burden on our skilled workforce. They have choices, they can move elsewhere. They're very knowledgeable about what those taxes are doing to their cost of living, and taxes are very much a cost of living. So the one thing that I would urge is that we keep our eye on the tax impact, not only on companies, but also on individuals, because it is about affordability.
we have spent so much time talking about people and how we can get more young Vermonters to go to college, how we can get more skilled workers here in Vermont. And I think that's all great, but at the end of the day, in Vermont, we still have a large amount of service sector jobs. We have a lot of agritourism, a lot of manufacturing that doesn't require that advanced degree. So I think a part of the solution really needs to be professionalizing some of those jobs, putting pressure on employers, making jobs more livable, and working with high schools.
I would add to what the previous gentleman said, in that if there can be a concerted effort in attracting high school internships to occur, which may turn into permanent employment, that could also free up the valuable workforce that may be underemployed currently to fill the positions where employers are finding it difficult to fill.
And just state your name for the record, please.
Eve Lutton, Vermont High.
Just add along that, people are talking about finding jobs or finding people to take jobs that are going unfilled. The chamber just entered into an agreement with the Vermont Youth Conservation Corps, whereby we have guaranteed an interview, not a job, an interview with one of our members for any of their graduates who score on their test. They have a test at the end of their summer, 85 or above. And there are about 30 to 40 kids a year who are not going back to college, who frankly have dropped out of school, who want to stay in Vermont, and who are looking to find a job. They can work in teams, they know how to show up for work, they know how to dress appropriately for work, they can pass a P-test. So they're starting to graduate now. If anybody is looking for employees, and they run the gamut from the service sector to early entry tech, give me a holler at the chamber. They're starting to send names to me, and we'll send them to you. Frankly, I don't care if you're a chamber member or not. I'd love to have everybody in the state as a chamber member. Our job is to make sure that we get kids placed. So along the lines of what you all are saying, if you have somebody, if you're looking for employees, give me a holler. I'll get you some names. That's a solution.
Is there any sort of statewide inventory of training opportunities or clearinghouse? We have all these wonderful programs, but if I'm a young person, which I'm not, I haven't read it to Tom, he'll tell me about this opportunity, but otherwise, I don't know where to go. Has that been discussed?
We did, just because we were getting confused, put together a list of training providers. So give me a card.
So we can put the bell on the cat, right?
Yeah, it's heavy.
Through the Tech Council, we created a site that's live if you want to look at it. It's a very simple site. It's called Innovate Vermont, and it is to try to help entrepreneurs and innovators direct them to resources and resource providers in the state. So something like that was pretty simple to set up, and it's been good.
Yeah, I know we're talking about incentives to employers, and I'm wondering, off of Jen's suggestion about the need to professionalize service sector jobs, almost as a transition or a bridge, I'm wondering if there is a way to formalize relationships between social services that provide child care and transportation to lower income Vermonters, so that we've called it the benefits cliff, so that people who are facing the choice, am I going to go to work for a slightly above minimum wage job and then have to pay child care because it puts me up above my reach up cutoff or whatever? And I know, Annie, that's been something high on your agenda. I just don't know how, but it does seem to me that the Workforce Development Board, the legislature, higher ed, that we all need to somehow work together to make sure that people who are maybe under educated but skilled and ready to work at entry-level jobs can, without losing child care, heat subsidy, transportation subsidy, those things. I don't know what that falls under, except benefits cliff.
Yeah. So Frank, what I continue to hear from different employers in different areas
is they can't find the employee that they need to fill the job, to fill it. So for example, I'm on the board of the visiting nurses in Rutland. We're hiring travelers. And we're not alone. There are other organizations throughout the state that are hiring travelers. And I would take it a step below reaching out to high school guidance counselors and start out at the junior high level and try to get some of these kids to shadow people in the healthcare professions. We know we have a shortage of docs in the state except for Chittenden and Windham counties. The rest of the state is way underserved. And when you a couple things that you said really tweaked me. Because when I hear that the two gubernatorial candidates are looking for ideas, by now they both should have some pretty good ideas about what's wrong in the state. And it doesn't take a rocket scientist to realize that government's got to start getting out of the way. We've got to stop doing things like 9L. When we have the chair of the Natural Resources Board said there's nothing broken in the permitting system, and yet one business can extort another business to get their permit and look for a payout. I mean, that is broken in my mind. And they're, you know, when you talk to the General Electrics of the world and companies like that, it's all about overall costs. And every year they have to try to bring down their cost of doing business. And it doesn't really matter to them so much where they're bringing it down, whether it's energy costs, tax costs, whatever, but they've got to lower their cost of doing business, and they're under constant pressure to do that. And yet all we seem to do at the State House is raise the cost of doing business, put more impediments in the regulatory system, and I don't know, it's just disturbing to hear that candidates are searching for ideas when there's a lot that has been said for the last 20, 30 years, and people haven't followed up on that. And when I hear you and your concern about Chittenden County, think about the rest of us. When we look at that chart and we see 2008 to now, the Great Recession to now, and jobs in the state, and we see the statewide average here, Chittenden County here, and the whole rest of the state down here, just think how frustrated we are.
We know. Kathy.
So I have two suggestions. One, I think has already been talked about, was last time you talked about how the money following the children from the education to the career centers. I think that needs to shift. I think it's really important that somehow the technical and career centers are continue to be funded, but, and I don't have I don't know how this will happen, but the schools lose their money, so they don't send those middle, the kids that are going to be lost. They're intelligent. They just don't want to go to the tech centers because that's no longer considered educational. So somehow that's got to shift. So where people are encouraging to send people to the tech centers, so they learn best with the trades. They don't necessarily learn the best sitting at a desk. So somehow we got to create the ability to shift that. And I know that's been discussed for the last 3 or 4 years. I know Michelle's been involved in it, but it really needs to shift. The second thing I think is for businesses, and this is more specific. One size does not fit all. The mandates that come down from the State House to try to protect workers doesn't necessarily always fit, especially in the service industry. So while you want to take care of the people who are in the workforce, the more you mandate, the less happens, the less ability that the employers have to actually provide the services that are directly necessary for a particular trade. The idea that we maybe be creative and support someone who, or a group of people who go and educate employers and employees about grief in the workplace. You mentioned your daughter died, and I'm sorry, I didn't know that. I understand, and I'm sorry that you've gone through that, or you're going through it. $75 billion on an annual basis is lost to and revenues in the workplace because of grief. And it's not just the direct loss of a loved one, it's divorce, it's loss of jobs, it's caring for a sick parent, it's sickness. $75 billion a year. One out of three people are grieving in your workplace at any given day, and it's lost because of distractions in the workplace. How about being creative about PSAs and sending people into workplaces so where you can educate employers about how important it is to help people grieve in a healthy way that costs them absolutely nothing except for the person who comes in and trains them? That's my other hat. That's not AGC. That's what I do on the side for my own issue, but I think that's really critical. You can save money, you can keep, you can create a more loyal group of employees, and an employer is going to appreciate their employees more if they know how to handle some of those challenges. They don't always have the money to give a $10 raise or across the board paid leave, maternity leave, or family leave, but they have ways to be creative. And I think that just paying for PSAs or even contracted with someone to go out and do that and educate people will shift the direction you're heading.
I would like to see a much broader and deeper relationship between the Agency of Human Services and Economic Development. We have an available workforce. We have reach-up participants. And I think WIO does play a nice bridge and provides a valuable tool for this connection between the two worlds. But we have reach-up participants. We have people being served through our Department of Mental Health. That's an available workforce. We have our Department of Disabilities, Aging, and Independent Living. That's an available workforce. We are the second oldest state in the country. We need to capitalize on people who are elderly and senior who are able to work. I think, you know, we can take some of our public assistance dollars and think differently about this by providing deeper and better incentives to businesses who are willing to take a chance on folks who are on public assistance or who are attached to the Agency of Human Services in some way, but economically disempowered for whatever reason, give businesses incentives, provide supportive services, and really link human services with the business world. I think we have to use our available workforce, and there are a lot of people out there who can do really good things with the proper supports and an understanding of business and have the incentives to take a chance.
Yeah.
One of the things I think, unfortunately, we tend to do is sort of that peanut butter schmear effect. We have so many good people in the state, so many good ideas, we have so many good leaders, and we've come up with so many good ideas. And the part that I think we are challenged with often is then being able to assess what's a really good idea, and what's just like an okay idea, it's fine, but like it's not really going to turn the curve. And so what I'm wondering about is, could we as a board have an appetite for taking all of these great ideas and maybe coming up with two or three that we commit to for a couple of years to really push hard on? And we needed, if we were to do that, we would need some kind of an evaluation process to assess what really is like gonna be that leverage point that if you really hit it hard, we have the greatest opportunity of moving things the fastest and having a ripple effect on other things. We don't have to take everything on because we're really pushing on those drivers. So I just want to throw out one possibility as one of those potential drivers. Came up in the notes from the last meeting, which is around guidance counselors. And if we're and because of the fact that so many of the guidance counselors are having to deal with stuff that has nothing to do with getting kids into careers or helping them to find a CTE program or whatever, if we were to figure out how could we solve the guidance counselor challenge that they face in schools, getting social workers to take all of the stuff that's social work oriented off of guidance counselors' hands and just have them focus on career development or whatever it is. Like, I'm just wondering if we could come up with a handful of those kinds of initiatives that we could really work on together and just say, you know what, all those other great ideas, that's great, but let's put them in the parking lot for now and just let's just really hit two or three or four really hard over the next couple of years and solve them.
I just wanted to follow up on what Greg and Kevin said about internships and reaching out to middle or high school kids. We can't work with middle-aged kids because of regulations and bring them into workplace. We can do field trips and things, but I would really stress to employers to get high school kids in through career and technical education. You can do work-based learning experiences. You can do two different kinds. One, kids can actually get high school credit for. Others, they're just doing kind of field experience to find out. The other thing is field trips. Last year, we took two field trips with our students to Revision. And because of that, because they could see what this kind of a program, we have a mechatronics program, what this program is going to end up with as a career, we had 12 kids sign up for the program, whereas the year before we didn't have any. So they're actually seeing, okay, if I take these technical skills, I can go on this career pathway, I can do that. And it's not too soon to tell the middle school kids, but it gets a little complicated. And even elementary kids, we have elementary kids coming in doing after school STEM programs so they can learn about things because their wheels are already spinning. So I would say reach out and bring young people into your businesses so that they can see what kind of jobs and what kind of futures they have, because it would be an investment in your future employees.
Hi, this is Steve again from High Tech. I'm curious if anybody there could speak to the success, or maybe it did or didn't work, for the STEM employee incentive that was back probably 4 years ago, maybe 5 years ago, and see if that could be resurrected for other key employment opportunities that the state may be challenged with in the future. And it does not necessarily be STEM, but I'm curious what the success was previously.
Yeah, let's see, LaRisha, Secretary.
Lucy, can you come forward so that Steve can hear your answer?
Sure. So I'm the Secretary of the Agency of Commerce and Community Development. We administer the STEM program, and we found that it was pretty successful. The funding that came for that program came from the Next Generation Fund, and it was a pretty fixed amount of money, and it was pretty limited. The students that we had that went through the program were successful. They were employed in Vermont. We had some attrition, as you would imagine any program would. I don't have the data and the numbers with me right now. I do have that back at the office. We decided to discontinue that when the Vermont Strong Scholars Program was passed in a couple of legislative sessions ago. Sadly, however, just to give you a little background, the Vermont Strong Scholars Program was a STEM-focused program where we were looking at both associate's and bachelor's degrees and in very specific fields. And that was going to become an entitlement program. The VSAC was going to administer it. We had a lot of the work done to get that moving, but it really needed an appropriation. And when the program was fully built out in like year 10 or something like that, it was looking at $3.5-4 million. And it was a big chunk, I think, for the legislature to take on. And ultimately, in this world of scarce resources, it fell away. And so the program was passed, it was never funded. It's still on the books, but that was going to replace STEM. STEM was phased out. We were going to reappropriate the STEM appropriation from NextGen into Vermont Strong Scholars, so that never happened because Vermont Strong Scholars has not gotten off the ground, and it doesn't mean that it couldn't in the future, but that's what that is.
Okay, thank you.
Rebecca?
Well, first of all, I just wanted to respond to what Kathleen had said, and I mean, I thought you were going to say that CTE is not your daddy's CTE anymore. I really have to say that, because some of the work that's going on in the Career Tech Center is really exciting. And the composition is changing. You've all heard about the 20% decline in student population. That is not true in our CTE population. It's actually held strong over the last 20 years, so it actually represents a larger proportion of our total student population. And part of the success is that you've managed to customize your offerings a little bit more, and you're bringing in a much more diverse population. So it's not in all places still that that's where you go if you can't do school. We're seeing kids go to CTE for incredibly rigorous tech programs and sort of math-infused programs that then go on to Rochester Polytech, or whatever it is, Institute of Technology. So it's not the same program, and I really have to encourage people to go visit your CTE if you haven't done so, because it really is different. But I'm just looking back at some of this data that was presented earlier, and what I think we have to be a little bit honest about is what we're seeing is the hollowing out of the middle, which is sort of a national phenomenon. And what we see is that if you have a lot of education, there are opportunities for you. If you have no skills, you will have a job. It just won't pay you well enough to live a decent life. What we see in our data at the Agency of Education, we just looked at our ACT data, there is a direct correlation between how well you score and the probability you will leave the state for education. Higher scoring kids leave the state and they don't tend to come back. So what it is I worry that we're creating a place where many of our students don't see opportunity, and they don't see Vermont as a place where they can get a good job that helps them live in our communities and support their kids. And I think we have to figure out how to go after that. And you know, I see it particularly living on the other side of the state, where I see people make living choices just based on the taxes. I mean, someone said that here, I think you said it. And they put their kids in our Vermont schools the day they graduate, they're out of state with their higher incomes. And that's something we really do have to think about. So I would caution us, as we think about how we move forward, to be really mindful of our own mindset in terms of how we stimulate economic development and prepare people, and be very wary of the scarcity mindset, because it's very easy to get into a zero-sum game. It's AHS or AOE, it's labor or something else. Because what we really need, we have finite resources, I would argue, and I think, Paul, you were headed there, that we probably need to find a safe way to have a conversation about whether the way we're spending our state investment is actually getting the most mileage out of it. And it may be that we have to be a little more pragmatic and strategic about some of the investments we make. When I look at the pre-K data, there's a 13 percentage point difference in the number of kids who live in poverty who enrolled in pre-K and the kids who live in poverty who are enrolled in K through 4. So we're not getting the highest poverty kids in the same proportion yet. So we need to be able to ask, why is it? Because those are the kids who are going to grow up and they're the most likely to stay in Vermont. And if those are the kids who are going to grow up and be the future Vermonters, how do we make sure that we are investing early, giving them the support they need so that they can go on and have wonderful opportunities and take advantage of fabulous CTE programs or whatever it is. And as you said, I think we also need to pivot from saying the only way to be successful in Vermont is with a four-year college degree. And I think, you know, again, I think the CTEs have done a terrific job. I think some schools have really pushing the personalized learning process, and I thank the legislature for giving us that Act 77 flexible pathways legislation to do work-based internships while still in school, and to begin to think about college courses in high school so that they can see that there is a way to go forward, often to an electrician certification. And you can make more as an electrician than I can. It's a good thing, and we have really devalued trades, and we need to find a way to bring back value to that kind of hard work, which is skilled work, and which we have need for here in the state of Vermont. So I think there is, we need to think about the big messages we sent, and then I think some of the little details in terms of how the agencies and the partners work together will fall in place. I don't think we have the big messages focused yet.
No. Janet.
Yeah.
Oh, so those of you who know me probably won't be surprised with what I'm gonna say. I'm gonna build off education, because I think I agree the trades have been undervalued and the two-year degree has been undervalued. And a two-year technical degree from VTC will bring you an extremely high rate wage, much better than a bachelor's degree in communications from Middlebury, okay? And that's the reality of in Vermont. However, our education system has shortchanged that population of kids that aren't going anywhere because they didn't get enough rigor. In the state, and this was even in, you can tell the governor, he said this in his state of the state 5 years ago, 6 years ago, until we mandate Algebra 1, Algebra 2, and Geometry as mandatory math classes in our high schools. I don't care how much you want to flex your path, you can't do that. It's, there's plenty of research that shows if you don't, A, take that, you don't develop an analytical mind, you cannot go be an electrician, you cannot go into VTC. We see our employees that are really good production workers that want to move on in their careers, and we want to move them on, have no math skills, they can't go anywhere. Sorry, we'd love to give you opportunity, and we've tried. And so we're not giving these kids these building blocks, and a particular concern for me as boys, you know, people say to me, oh, you're a woman engineer, aren't you worried about all the girls? And I'm like, no, absolutely not. Just go look at the statistics. You know, our boys have fallen off the cliff. Yeah. And we need a Save a Boy campaign. Yeah. Big time. No, I'm serious. It's very, very scary. So to me, math mandated rigor in all our high schools. You don't get to pick which three math courses you want. Advanced checkbook 1, 2, and 3 does not count. You must have Algebra 1, Algebra 2, and Geometry. You're just not going to survive. If you go look at any VTC program, even nursing, dairy management, you have to have math, right? You can't go into the trades if you don't have basic math skills. So we need to up the rigor in the math. We can't make it voluntary. We need to look at our boys hard and figure out what to do. And we need to make sure people understand the trades, and the two-year degree path is an excellent path, excellent salaries. You can call your own shots now in some of these things, and we've highly underrated it. So that's my annual math speech. I just want to switch directions on early childhood, because I'm a huge fan of early childhood education. However, I think we've created unintended consequences here, which are, if you understand the financials of a child care center, preschoolers subsidize babies and toddlers. That's kind of the net. And when we moved preschoolers into the school system, the daycares lost the financial model to operate and provide care for infants and toddlers. And as an employer, obviously we need people to be able to find daycare and affordable daycare. And while it was great, we improved things for 3 and 4 year olds, we just didn't. The under 3 population. So if you don't understand the economics of that, you can see.
So just to be clear, most of our pre-K students are actually in private providers. So they can do that.
Yeah, because I think what you said, Virginia, it matters if you are a private provider that is not F-166 pre-qualified. Yes. As an employer, I know more about this than I thought I ever would as an employer. We're dealing with it right now with our provider, and the extent to which a private provider has a pre-qualified, it competes. Yes. Very effectively with the schools.
I feel
at least that's my experience.
I think it's real. It should have been a 0 to 5 discussion.
Yes.
Right. So, anyway. Thank you.
Anybody else? Anybody on the phone?
I'm just curious. I mean, I like what Ellen had to say about maybe going after 2 or 3 ideas, but wondering whether it's the role of this body to come up with 3 goals that we could agree on so that we could understand and determine which ideas would be good. I'm just not sure if that's within this purview, but there are a lot of good ideas. It's just which ones would we go after, and how does that, you know, what are our goals? Why don't we set some goals?
Whether it's
more internships, yeah, or, you know, what is the number?
The interesting thing is that we're in a lame duck period. We're going to change leadership of the administration, lieutenant governor's seat, and the entire legislature. So, but our work continues. So a new governor can come in and pick up the best of the best ideas, because all these resources are in process. So if we prioritize and give that new governor the priorities, then that governor can act quickly.
But Frank, how do we get those ideas put together? Like with this group, to say, this is the big picture. Everyone's really smart here.
Mm-hmm.
here's the three things
how do we develop
want you
the
to focus on as the next governor or administration. Like, it's going to be education. It's going to be, and there's three points in there. Like, this is all we want you to focus on, governor. And here's the incentive stuff that we want changed. And here's whatever the workforce connection stuff we're talking about here. Like, that's it. Here's nine things. This is our recommendation. That's it. Because we just heard 25 things.
Right.
Which are probably all great.
So, and some but people have spoken up, so we're going to ask anybody who didn't feel comfortable, I understand that, email us some ideas as well. We'll compile this whole list, send it out to everybody, and then our next meeting, we're going to work at narrowing it down. And then we're going to put some meat on the bones of those ideas. I think everybody liked what Ellen proposed, which was focus. I'll use her as an example. If Ellen had the idea of farm to plate, and now it's become a pretty interesting driving value-added sector of our ag economy here in Vermont. But if she didn't do that and just say, I want to do 20 different things, she said, I'm doing this, and worked for a decade to make it happen, then it happened, and that's what we have to do. We got to focus.
Don't. When's the next meeting?
Next meeting. We're going to do December.
December.
We're going to give it to the governor when they're, you know, from November 9th through January 1st, they're trying to find secretaries, commissioners, staff, and the only thing they know is they've inherited the budget that they've inherited for the next 6 months. So really to put something in place, we've been working for quite a while. So we're going to be able to give that governor something. And, you know, I think it's a wonderful thing that they asked for ideas. They've got their own ideas. They knew this group was meeting. And they said, you know, utilize these folks who are the experts in their areas to generate more ideas for us. And I'm really appreciative that they both did that. Tom, and then we'll go to...
Well, so let me throw two more ideas in the mix along with Ellen's. But one is the idea that we need better data on what's working now. And we need the measurement systems, data collection systems that are much simpler, because I think a lot of our collection system relies right now on doing a study and looking into it instead of an ongoing, just by design, continuous system that everyone would have access to in a way that wouldn't sacrifice any one person's confidential information. But I think it does give up a survey. It requires some trust in, I think, the state to collect the data and then to provide it back out to the public in an aggregate way. And this is something we began talking about with the Sustainable Workforce Development Sustainable Funding Committee. And I bring up annually, along with Janet, you know, sort of one of the ideas I get to once a year pop up and suggest. Because I think we know some of the things that work, or at least we have hunches about what works. We have anecdotal evidence, but we don't have continuous data, and we don't have, you know, that really proves it. We don't have sufficient data to drive government investment and private investment into these things that we think are working. So I think that's the difference. The other thing is we often are talking about this. I think it's a trade-off between environmental regulation, public regulation to protect health and safety, other things like that, and enterprise, business enterprise, and how do we bridge these two things. And there is a real regulatory hurdle when you want to do something. And, you know, as a nonprofit, we get to experience it too. When we want to build a new building or, you know, get, you know, zoning approved or something. I think the model that Project WorkSafe offers, where as a business you can go in and say, hey, come in, do an inspection of our facility. We will agree to fix whatever problems you uncover. But you're not going to slap our wrists, you're not going to fine us. It's going to be a partnership to get it done, because we believe we want to be in compliance, we want to be safe. And I think most businesses want to have safe processes that protect the workers, but also safe processes that protect the environment and the public. And so if we went forward with some collaborative agreement, if you sign up in this program, you're going to get assistance to be compliant. And so long as you follow all the steps, you're going to get help to come out the other end. There's sort of more certainty for the business. And so I would love to sort of suggest the Project WorkSafe as a model that many more of our regulatory processes could be based upon. There could be sort of a voluntary component where you sign up, you agree, the lawyers don't get to come to the table, and you get things done. And you get the support needed to do it.
Alan, yes?
Paul,
sorry. Yeah.
We have about 20 employees, and they don't really know who they're working for on any given day. We have a kind of a hybrid setup where these four businesses interact. And it's working really well with the young kids. But the reason I started those businesses was because of my aging workforce. There's a lot of issues that happen somewhere around 50 that don't go away. You have to be able to adjust to their needs, which usually means losing some time during every week of the year for each man. So mm-hmm. I never have a full crew because one of my men, and they all have multiple things related to construction, just does it to your body. Now, their mind says go, their body says no. And yet, they're all mentors. They could easily train a youngster. The dynamics of that get complicated when we're especially billing by the hour and we're on a job. The clients don't want to pay the extra premium for the guy that knows everything and can do it by himself twice as fast as he does when he's training somebody to work alongside him. So, I've thought this through for at least a month because the mature workforce is something near and dear to my heart. The kids, I see them as a youth group. The problem with that is if you hire somebody that's in the 10th grade, 16 years old or something, you also hire their parents. You don't know you're doing that. You just find out later because he goes home sweaty and dirty. And he, there needs to be some sort of boot camp situation where these kids actually get the full experience of what it's like to be in the real world without going home and whining to mom. And then you get a letter from their lawyer. They don't even bother to call you. They just send you letters. So, it's not unsolvable because you need to create some sort of way for the aging workforce who don't want to retire. And the last thing they want to do is learn something new when they've got, they can take engines out on the weekend, they can wire up a solar system, if you can think it, they can build it, they make guitars and boats on the weekends, and the young kids are fascinated with that whole thing. And they'll take them home with them and they'll do that, they'll keep them out of trouble. But you gotta get them early. We've all talked about K through whatever, but when it comes to kids, I'll take them at ninth grade and get them their GED on the job. I could do that. I really could. And they would find out when they're working, whether they like electrical work or whether they like, I do a lot of electronic digital drafting. Some of the kids are just fascinated with that. It looks like a video game with a purpose. They can build something and draw a doghouse. We'll go out back and we'll build it. But I want you to draw it first. Draw a picnic table. How many of you can draw a picnic table? It's not as easy as you think. So it's little things like that that I show them how to do really fast on AutoCAD, and they're stunned by it. They love it. And the next thing you know, there's one out being hurt. And most of my older guys work on weekends. The truth is about the older guys, they have to take 4 or 5 breaks during the day. And in construction, there's usually only one. And so there's that whole dynamic of making sure that it all works, not just for the young kids, but for the older ones. And they've got their parents. Somewhere around 50, the aging parents kicks in. You think the aging workforce is bad. Well, you got an aging workforce whose aging parents are kicking in. Not only that, your kids are graduating from college. Yeah. Now they've got to go to college. And so they're taking care of their parents. Their kids are going to college. You've got to choose a college, which can take a month. What's in going here, they're going there for a week, and all of this stuff. But the bottom line is, it's still very rewarding. Most of my aging workforce are household words in the sports field, like the Red Sox. We built a lot of Red Sox homes in Philadelphia, the Phillies, and the Eagles. Done a lot of good stuff, and this is the stuff the little kids just love. They're going to get to meet these people. And, you know, and it's like they just met God, you know. To them, they did, you know, and they get to meet sports players and things like that. That's unique, but we work on Killington, and everybody comes up to Steve from Boston, and we get to meet people like that. But when you can bring a kid in, and that person of that caliber begins to say, now I trust you to do a good job, he's going to do a good job. So I say that in a positive way, because those things are on my mind. I can think of 100 reasons why, you know, at my age, I wouldn't want to deal with any of it and just go, you know, float my boat somewhere. I don't feel that way. I really don't. The guys that have been with me are over 30 years employed with me. I'm not going to desert them, and I have no intentions of going anywhere else. But only thing I can think of is some sort of tax credit situation. Or, if you're employing these children, there's no cost to the owner for his labor. How do I though, pay him? Mm-hmm. How can we get his GDP on the job? And one of our employees, my son, has got his educational degree. All this stuff started to make sense to us, but I don't know how everybody else could do that. But we certainly could. That's enough for me to say. I think it's very positive.
Good.
What I'm hearing.
Thank you. Grant, you have your...
I think... Maybe if, when you send us the 20 whatever ideas, the idea is to pick five, rate five, so we come back out of the five, we can get three. Otherwise, if we start out with 20 at the next meeting, you know, maybe we can narrow it down ourselves before the next meeting,
okay,
where we prioritize them and get it back to you.
Ellen?
As much as we hate homework.
I'm just wondering if there's been any thought of whether or not there are some sector-specific initiatives that would be particularly useful to prioritize around. You know, you hear about computer engineer types. Like, I'm just wondering, you know, it seems like a lot of individual businesses can go to Vermont Tech or other places and get specific assistance that way. But I'm just wondering, are there other things we could be doing that are more sector specific that we could focus on for a couple of years, for instance, and then a few others?
Given that the service sector is so big, and we've got human resources here saying, and I think I heard Secretary Holcomb say the same thing, is there a way to look at the resources that are being spent in the state, whether it's in human resources or in education or transportation or whatever? Could that be one of the things where we're actually looking at professionalizing that service sector workforce with help from the money that right now is trickling in different directions in the state agency, but it's that cusp of poverty potential worker that could really, that we could make a difference for, but that would also make a difference to employment in the service sector as one of the priority sectors.
And I'm also wondering, attached to that, whether or not we're fully engaging all of the different types of trade associations. You know, like the trades, they do a lot of workforce development and training, apprenticeships, those kinds of things. But, for instance, general contractors, the Vermont Cheese Council, there's a number of different types of trade associations. And I'm just wondering if we're leaving some people out that could really be helpful in terms of actually moving some things forward.
General contractors are doing
great.
Awesome.
So one of the thoughts as I stood here listening was to, just for the folks that couldn't be here and then out to everybody, is just send out, we'll send an email out, just a call for ideas, summarize what we have here today, and then get some more from everyone. And if you can, forward it to some other entities that you think we should be reaching out to. Then we'll take all that, compile all that, and get that out to you as was suggested prior to our next meeting, and have you prioritize so we can get in the room and start winnowing things down. How does that sound, Kathy?
Just with that said, will we still share all the ideas with both the candidates instead of,
yeah.
I think it's important that we narrow it down and focus on particular ones. I agree.
Yeah.
But I think all the ideas should be able to go to both candidates.
Yes.
And, yeah.
Yep.
Or whomever, in the end, whoever
yep.
wins.
Yep.
All right.
we have guests here. Do we have any comments from our guests? Well, if not, we're not going to keep you here until 4, just because our agenda said we're going to stay until 4. So, do we have any other business today? If not, thank you so much for making the time and your creativity here. We'll be back to you soon. Have a great day and enjoy that fall day.